IRS collection agencies.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Kingdompreneur Radio this week. I'm Dr. Rollan Roberts, and we are not live yet. We'll be going live here in just a moment. But I wanted to just give everyone a chance to get on and for us to visit offline before 100,000 people start tuning in. But it's been a great week, and a lot has happened. A lot of challenges, a lot of obstacles, a lot of amazing things, a lot of breakthroughs. And I'm going to be sharing a lot of those today. And it's a special program. It's bold versus stupid and how to know the difference. And I don't know about you, but I've been bold in business and I've been stupid in business. I've been bold in relationships and I've been stupid in relationships. I've been bold in life decisions. I've been stupid in life decisions. So we're going to talk about those things today. I've got a special section on haters and people who just are very evil towards you, or there's a lot of animosity or bitterness, whatever it is. And so I'm going to give you some pointers there. And I'm also giving, I've got 12 steps or 12 ways to know if the people that are around you are being bold or stupid. Because part of it is you may not be bold or stupid, but they may be bold or stupid, and it's going to cost you. And so I'm going to give that to you. And obviously we'll be taking your phone calls. So make sure you tune in. Some people have already sent messages to me with some questions. And if that's you, then go ahead and you can message some more questions. Or I don't see all of them online. All right. So you need to call is the best way to get in the queue. And that number is 407-682-9595. So make sure that you you do that, and then I'll definitely get to the question. So it's going to be a great day. Kimberly, great to see you. I'm going to be talking about the Women's Empowerment Conference here on the air, actually. We'll be commenting about that. The Ministry Orphanage. Need your support and help over here. Very good. Thanks for letting me know about the Ministry Orphanage. Is that in Africa, I assume? I'm not sure what part of the world that's in, or that your ministry is in. But we'll be going live here in about 60 seconds. Nick, when do we go live?
In about 1 minute.
Very good. Thank you. Sacrifice. Hi, Shannon and Starla. Good to see you all. Can't wait to have you all on the CEO cruise and speaking on that. That's going to be amazing. Incredible story. Romantic getaway for a summer missions trip. You sacrifice because you love your children and you want them to have every advantage. Make sure you call in or send your questions in, and we'll get them answered today. It's going to be a great show. Send your son or daughter to the finest Christian schools in Central Florida. I have. That's right. When you go to amazingradiodeals.com, you'll find half off tuition for some of our community's most reputable faith-based schools, ranging college, and you won't have to sacrifice hours in the car either. Our partner schools are located throughout the Orlando area, and chances are there's one near you. You want the best for your child. You're willing to sacrifice, and here at 94.9 FM and AM 950 The Word, we're ready to help with half-price tuition to faith-based schools. Explore your options today at AmazingRadioDeals.com. That's AmazingRadioDeals.com.
94.9 FM and AM 950.
Central Florida's WTLN Orlando.
The Word, where faith comes by hearing.
Kingdompreneur Radio is paid for by Courageous.
You've waited 10,080 minutes, 168 hours, and 7 days for this moment. Welcome to Kingdompreneur Radio, the only business call-in show on Christian radio. Join CEO and host Dr. Rollan Roberts as he takes your calls live and solves the biggest challenges you have in business. Entrepreneurs, this is for you. Bringing to you now the founder and CEO of Courageous and former CEO of the Hoverboard Company. Here's Dr. Rollan Roberts.
Hello, Kingdompreneurs, and welcome to Kingdompreneur Radio. You may be hurting today. Your finances may be tight. Your relationships may be deteriorating. Your business may be struggling. But over the next hour, I am taking your calls to grow your kingdom business, turn around your company, resurrect dead relationships, instantly improve your productivity, and dramatically restore your happiness, joy, and peace. I'm Dr. Rollan Roberts, and this is Kingdompreneur Radio, helping you live your faith in business. You will be a better person 60 minutes from now than you are at this moment. I'll be right back to take your calls.
Kingdompreneur Radio is brought to you by Cardiff Lexington Corporation, a publicly traded company under symbol CDIX. If you're a business owner interested in selling to pull equity out of your business and would like to stay on board or are looking for growth capital, visit www.cardifflexington.com.
Welcome back to Kingdompreneur Radio. I'm your host, Dr. Rollan Roberts, and I'm taking your calls today. Today is all about you and your business. I'm going to help you understand the difference between bold versus stupid and how to know the difference. A lot of times I've been bold or thought I was being bold, and I was actually being really stupid. And then sometimes I thought I was being stupid, but it was actually really, really bold and amazing things happened. So we're going to talk about the difference. How do you know the difference between being bold in your life decisions, in your relationships, and being stupid in your relationships, or being bold in expanding your business or buying a business, starting a business, versus being stupid about it? How about with just different life decisions, doing this versus doing that, growing in your career, switching careers, all whatever it is? That's what we're going to be talking about today. And if you've got a question, I want you to call in 407-682-9595, 407-682-9595, and we'll get your questions answered live on air. You can also watch us live. A lot of people like to see the behind the scenes and commercial breaks and the hand signals and all the other stuff that we do in the studio. And you can do that by going to verycourageous.com. Very courageous, V-E-R-Y, courageous.com. And, you know, I actually got that domain recently because I was reading in Joshua 1, and I love the book of Joshua anyway because it's really bold and it's courageous and it's about doing amazing things and taking ground. And as an entrepreneur, that's what we do. We want market share. We want to grow. We want to expand. And but I saw something that I'd never seen before. I always talk about Joshua 1:9, and we always see things with Joshua 1:9. But in this case, I actually saw back up in verse 5, number 1, there shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. People, do you know what that means to an entrepreneur? Do you know what that means to a business person? If you say nobody's going to be able to come against you, they'll come against you, but they won't be successful. They won't be able to stand before you all the days of your life. For the rest of your life, nobody can come against you. They will try, but they will not prevail, because I will be with you just like I was with Moses. I'm going to be with you, and I'm not going to fail you. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm not going to leave you. And I know you're used to that, but I'm not going to do it. What a promise. I mean, as an entrepreneur, I can tell you there's a lot of lonely days. There's a lot of lonely nights and lonely mornings and just lonely period. And that is a powerful promise. But I go on to verse 7, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do all according to all the law, which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. Well, I mean, I definitely want to prosper wherever I go, and whatever I touch, I certainly want to have the Midas touch and it be blessed and favored. But you got to go back and just say, only be strong and very courageous. See, in verse 9, what we always talk about is just, you know, be strong and of good courage. But to be very courageous, that's what inspired the theme for today's show, bold versus stupid. So give us a call, 407-682-9595. And I want to just kind of start off and just say, you know, how do you know the difference? And we're going to go in pretty deep with being bold versus stupid. But I can tell you this, that no matter how big or how small something, a decision may seem, it can be a small decision and you could still make a stupid decision. You can still do something very, very wrong. But it could also be something very, very courageous, even though it seems insignificant or very small. It took courage, but not the way you think of courage, for Joshua to walk around a wall for 7 days. You know, think about it. Think about this. If you were a mighty warrior, and God tells you to, like, walk around the wall 7 times, that's pretty humiliating. Like, it's like, wait, God, do you know the skills that you gave me? Like, they're not even mine. I didn't even ask for them. Like, you gave them to me. I can grow a business. I can double the size of a business. I can really do some amazing things, but yet you're not going to let me. You're going to tell me to walk around the wall 10 times and then it's going to fall. That's pretty humiliating. That's embarrassing, actually. I would like to just kind of go in and, you know, kill it and crush it and just dominate. And that's just not his way. That's how you think you're being bold and you're actually being stupid. I think about Gideon. Gideon, ironically, look, he had an army of 35,000 people, 32,000, excuse me, 32,000 warriors. And he was about to go into battle against the army the enemy had 135,000. So God was like, okay, it's 32,000 people against 135,000, and Gideon, you're 32,000, you've got too many people. I mean, like, as a CEO, I'd be going, let me refresh your memory on the numbers here. That 32,000, we already don't stand a chance against 135,000. And he's like, nope, you got too many people. So he said, what I want you to do is just tell them, anybody who's afraid, like, because you're going to get crushed, you know, let them go ahead and go home. Tell them if you're afraid, go home to your family. You know, you're not going to die today. And literally 22,000 people went home. 22,000 men went home. And so it left them with 10,000 people. And God's like, no, that's still too many people. I would be like, you know, I'm trying to build a business here. I'm trying to be successful. I'm trying to take some ground. I'm trying to grow. I'm trying to enter new markets and enlarge my territory. You've kind of already given it to me. So I'm just trying to like follow and obey what you've already done. So why are you like tying my hands behind my back, tying my legs together, and then telling me I've got to be successful, except you're handicapping me to no end, and you've got people in the world, the secular people, that they can make money however they want to. Sometimes it's illegal. Sometimes it's immoral. Sometimes it's unethical. Sometimes it's just rude, or it's evil, or it's something that is a vice and it causes problems in society as opposed to helping society. So it was just a really bad leadership from Gideon's perspective. He's saying, you are causing me to fail. You know, like, you are setting me up for complete failure here. So in that case, if you're Gideon, you probably would be saying, this is really stupid. Like, this isn't trusting God. This is being stupid. And what I want to know, listener, is what is it in your life that you're telling yourself that you think you're listening to God, but it's just, it sounds so stupid. And you're like, it is impossible that that's what I'm supposed to do. There's no way that that's what I'm supposed to do. That's where Gideon was. That's where Gideon was. And so anyway, the bottom line, he had too many men at 10,000, 10,000 against 135,000. It was still too many. He said, so what I want you to do is take them down to the creek in West Virginia. It's the creek. Take them down to the creek. And anybody who leans over and drinks the water directly out of the brook, send them home. And then the ones that kneel and just kind of scoop the water up, you know, that's who goes into battle with you. The bottom line, 9,700 warriors, you know, kneel and lap up the water. 300 scooped it up. And obviously, those 300 are being aware of their surroundings. They're warriors. They didn't let their guard down. And so 300 men against an army of 135,000. That is very stupid if you are a general, if you are or a president, or you are going into battle. That seems very stupid. But that seems stupid, but the story doesn't end there. He then said, he didn't tell him, you know, we're going to give you the greatest weapons of the day, and so you don't really need it. What he actually did was say, okay, now what I'm going to do is you're going to have, you know, an oil lamp in one hand, and then on, you know, when I say you're going to shout, you're just going to shout, and the oil lamps are on and so forth. And so literally Gideon, fortunately, followed what seemed logically very stupid. But if you think about it, it's actually extremely bold to do something that is counterintuitive. It's extremely courageous to do something that doesn't make sense. It takes so much faith to do something that is outside of the norm to how you would normally do it. If I'm going into battle against 135,000, if I'm trying to grow a company and you're supposed to do this, 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 and this, but you feel impressed to do this, this, and that, then it's important to know the difference. And there's one word that I want you to latch on to today, and it's discernment. Discernment is key. Discernment is everything. The second word is obedience. Obedience. Because it's one thing to discern and know the truth. Gideon knew what he should do, but he didn't. What if he didn't do it? You know, he could have been like, you know, this is ludicrous. I will take my 32,000 men and I am going to take on this 135,000, and it's going to be an ugly bloodbath. We're probably all going to die, and we're all probably going to lose, but I'm going to do it at least the most logical way of doing it. And that is not what happened here. Every single one of them would have died. In this case, it was one of the most successful victories in the battles that are documented in history, with 300 people defeating an army of 135,000 because of the confusion that it created. So when I think of Joshua, the mighty warrior, walking around a wall seven times and not getting to fight, and I think of Gideon having to charge with a very small army, I feel like that's so much of our lives, especially as believers, where we're trying to do what's right, and especially in business and in life. But it seems like we're already greatly outnumbered. We're already at 32,000 versus 135,000. But ultimately, when it comes down to who is with you, and I don't mean casually, I don't mean who you can just text or who you can just hang out with or whatever. Get over that. I'm talking about the people who stand with you, who believe in you, who give you grace and who give you mercy and who love you, and the people that are the true, true friends in your life. Those people, that's the 300. And so you have to discern that. Corinthians talks about bad company corrupting good people. You know, the good apple never makes the bad apples good. You hear that? The good apples never make the bad apples good. The bad apples always make the good apples bad. It's a law of nature, and it is to your own detriment when you do not recognize that the people that you spend time with, you become. You become like them, you think like them, you start making decisions like them, and then your outcome, your life starts looking like theirs. And I can tell you, if you don't want someone else's life, you don't listen to their counsel. You don't listen to their counsel. One of the biggest things I was thinking about this week, David. You know, David was anointed king 15 years before he actually took the throne. So imagine this. Imagine if I told you, you're going to be the CEO of Apple, but you're not going to be the CEO for another 15 years. You've got to just, live life but you're going to be the CEO. Well, as a leader and as an entrepreneur, that is extremely difficult because you want to start acting like that. The moment you and I know that we are headed a certain direction or that we're going to do something, it's very natural for us to already want to be there. Like the moment I know that I'm going to start a business, I don't sleep. I mean, I get the website up, I get the documents, I get whatever the product is, I work on things because I go all in. So if you know in advance what it is that kind of your destiny and your purpose, it is really difficult to live knowing that you're going to be there, but you're not there yet. You know what I'm talking about? It's very frustrating. That's really hard for a leader. And, you know, once in a while, you know, once you know where you're going to be, you just want to be there already. It's kind of like in traveling, you know, sometimes you just get me there already. But what you realize is that you just really do not have to force God's will or his plan. You really don't have to do that. You know, one of the things that I noticed was that, yeah, David, all right, so when he was chosen to be the king of Israel, one of the things that I noticed was he was in the field, right, tending the sheep. Samuel comes over and says, all right, Jesse, let's line up all your boys. You know, I'm going to anoint the next king of Israel. And it said that, God said he's in your house. So line them up. What's ironic about that is that he lines up his seven boys. He lines up David's seven brothers. David, like, wasn't even in the lineup. And he was such an afterthought in that family. It kind of shows you the pecking order. It shows you just how low and little they thought of him. And so he's out in the field tending sheep, and Samuel like goes down through each one of these guys, and like nobody is getting the nod. You know, nobody's getting anointed today. And he's frustrated, I'm sure. He's like, you know, I came all this way to anoint the next king of Israel, and he's nowhere to be found. But pretty sure I heard from God, like, he's in your house here. Well, so he's like, do you have any other sons anywhere? And Jesse goes, you know, well, I mean, I got this one that's out in the field tending some sheep. And so he calls for him to come up. And sure enough, obviously Samuel knew immediately, this is the anointed one. This is the next king of Israel. And he anoints him.
but he still had to wait 15 years before he took the throne. And there were several times during that that he, like I would have been, he tried to take matters into his own hands. He tried to fix things. He was like, God, I'm going to help you out. Like, I'm going to help you get me to the throne. So whenever Saul started trying to kill him, because he was like, oh, you're the next king? I'm going to go ahead and take your life so that you don't, like, try to overthrow my government. And David had the opportunity to kill him and pursued him and also ran for his life many times from Saul. But the bottom line is this. You may be David out in the field right now. You really may be David tending the sheep, doing something so seemingly insignificant with your life. And I'm telling you that nothing can stop God's plan for your life, for your business, and for what you're supposed to do, your purpose and your calling. You can be doing the most insignificant task right now, but you be faithful with it. And I'm telling you, he will send for you. Samuel sent for David, and God will send for you too. You do not have to force things. And that's the hardest part for me. I know for a lot of entrepreneurs, we just try to fix things. You know, we try to make things right. We try to make things better. You know, David went on to become the man after God's own heart, which is already hard for a lot of people to process because he, you know, had affairs. He committed murder. He ran from God. But he always repented. I mean, he was a horrible father. But he repented and he walked closely with the Lord. And that's one of the reasons, you know, I think God, it's like man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. And so, anyway, I want to share, a couple thoughts on, and I'm going to share a couple stories, that I was stupid and a couple stories where I've been bold. And I want you to call in with your stories as well, 407-682-9595. But there was one time, where I thought I was being really bold and wise, and I invested in these they were townhomes in a downtown district, and it was up and coming. The downtown was being revitalized, and so I thought, oh, I'm going to invest in this. This is going to be a killer investment. And bottom line, I was too early. I knew what was coming, and I knew that it would be valuable. I was just 10 years off. I was 10 years too early, and that was one of the biggest things, actually, where I've been stupid, was not the idea or the decision. It was my timing. My timing was off. And so that took me a long time to really learn. It took me a lot of failures to learn on business and when to launch products and when and where to launch them and how to launch them. And that's what a lot of virgin entrepreneurs do not understand are some of those principles. But I was very stupid. The other thing that I did that was stupid, and then I'm going to give you a couple stories that were bold that worked out but that seemed not too bright at the time, was one time – there was this stock that was supposed to be amazing. It was a guy I trusted, and I had done some deals with him in the past. It made some great money, and he told me, this is the one that you retire on, man. And so I literally wired him most every dime that I had in my bank account, and I signed over a 300,000 share stock certificate. Okay, let that process and sink in a little bit. Sent that to him, and literally 2 weeks later, the money was supposed to be like 10x or something, and it would have just, I mean, I would have been on retirement, you know. And I never heard from him again. This is somebody I'd been talking to, done investing with for several years. Never heard from him again. I thought I was being really bold and really smart, and I was being very stupid. I never once asked that. So when I come back, I'm going to give you 12 ways to know if the people in your life are being bold or stupid. The phone lines are open, so call 407-682-9595.
Entrepreneurs, business people, and Christian leaders, mark your calendars now for the 3-day, 2-night, all-inclusive, faith-based Bahamas CEO cruise, departing West Palm Beach October 7th through the 9th for only $49 per person plus port taxes and fees. For $49, you can join former Hoverboard CEO and Kingdompreneur radio host Dr. Rollan Roberts on this incredible experience, providing access to world-renowned business titans. It's access, relationships, business, worship, and breakthroughs in your swimsuit. Reserve your cabin now at www.ceocruise.com.
Some attribute the saying to the Greek philosopher Aristotle. If you want to avoid criticism, all you have to do is say nothing, do nothing, be nothing. On the other hand, if you decide your life is purposed for something worthy and being on the playing field is preferred to sitting in the stands, there is something you are sure to encounter. Barking Dogs. The dynamic new book, Dogs Don't Bark at Parked Cars, available now at Amazon.com, illustrates this encounter with the voices that find fault, who don't think it is possible, and who are unable to see a future alive with opportunities waiting to be seized. Unfortunately, these barking dogs are often right in our own heads. Simply put, go to Amazon.com and type in Dogs Don't Bark at Parked Cars and receive the wisdom gleaned from the author's own experience and hundreds of successful CEOs they interviewed over a decade, enabling you to bridge the chasm that is normally crossed only through trial and error. Get unstuck. Eliminate the frustration in building your business. The authors inspire and instruct those pursuing this journey with a central purpose to exalt freedom through ethical capitalism. Kingdompreneur Radio is brought to you by Cardiff Lexington Corporation, a publicly traded company under symbol CDIX. If you're a business owner interested in selling to pull equity out of your business and would like to stay on board or are looking for growth capital, visit www.cardifflexington.com.
Welcome back to Kingdompreneur Radio. I'm your host, Dr. Rollan Roberts, and I'm talking about bold versus stupid and how to know the difference. You know, one of the commercials that we just had was about dogs don't bark at parked cars. This is by Jeff Pearsall and Eric Wright. They're going to be in the studio with me next Saturday. I'm really excited to have them. They're highly successful kingdom entrepreneurs, and they wrote this book to help with ethical capitalism and things, but really, it's about the people, the voices in who always find fault. They think, you know, nothing's possible. It's always going to fail. They're unable to really see a future at all. And what this book does is just kind of help you recognize that most of those voices are actually in your head. There may be one or two physical people, but really the one who finds the fault and the one who doesn't think it's possible and doesn't see a future, it's probably you and it's probably in your head. And so as an entrepreneur, highly successful entrepreneurs, they have written this book, Dogs Don't Bark at Parked Cars. You can get it, pick it up on Amazon, but I'm really excited to have them in the studio next week. They've actually sponsored this show this month, and we're really instrumental in you even being able to hear it. So I'm very thankful for that. We've talked about several things. We've talked about Gideon and Joshua and, you know, some bold things that seemed very stupid logically. Like they should never have gone into battle with 300 people versus 135,000. That's just ludicrous. It's insane. You don't start a business with no money. You're supposed to plan. You're supposed to process. You're supposed to have some skill, talent, ability. But what's more important is discernment and obedience. So we kind of looked at those things. The phone lines are open, by the way, 407-682-9595. Feel free to call in with any questions you have or stories or just let's talk about if you're being bold or stupid right now in whatever it is that you're working on. So I shared a couple stories with you of the things that I thought were really bold and smart that turned out to be very stupid. I want to share a couple things, though, that were actually seemed stupid, but were actually bold. One was whenever I ran for the Senate. So that's a very dumb thing to do, number one. If somebody ever tells me that, I'm just going to start shaking my head and walk away. But really, look, here's the deal. If God calls you to do it, which is what I was saying, obedience is the only thing that makes it bold versus stupid whenever it doesn't seem logical. When the information does not validate process, the strategy, your experience, and you still believe you're supposed to do it, then that boldness, being Joshua 1:7, very courageous, you're being very courageous, not very stupid. So knowing the difference is critical. And when I ran for the Senate, you know, it caused a lot of problems. It was one of the best things that I've done, but it caused massive problems. That was the year they targeted, the IRS targeted conservatives. They came after me hot and heavy. You know, two IRS audits took me several years to close those out. And, you know, it was painful and it wasn't right. And I was falsely accused. And I remember wondering what the papers were going to say. Half the time it was amazing. Half the time they were against you or for you. They either loved you or hated you. And I never met them. And I'm going to be talking about enemies and haters in a minute. But, you know, the greatest person that despises me today has never talked to me in person, ever. Never talked to me in person. Never had a conversation other than to be rude or to threaten or to, you know, have animosity. And usually you'll find that that's the case. But it certainly is in politics. People have never even met me. And I remember being confused. Like, If you perceive me to be your enemy, I'm happy to sit down with you and talk, and let's just figure this out, because it can't be as bad as you're making it out to be. But I can tell you this, nothing ever gets better without conversation. Nothing improves without dialogue. You cannot overemphasize the value of a conversation. So running for the Senate was definitely something that not very, very bright, but it was very bold and very courageous, and it was really being obedient. And of course, one of the outcomes of that was my book, my most recent book, The 90 Day Race, which talks about my run for the Senate and how to do the impossible or achieve the impossible goal in 90 days. And that book is, I signed a contract a couple months ago. It will be in every Costco, BJ's, Target and Walmart and some airport stores in September of 2019. So, what seemed evil and animosity and all kinds of other things, that's really worked out for good. I mean, it's something that is paving the way for a lifetime of income, royalties, influence, and really, in fact, I was meeting with a business owner this past Tuesday night. I was introduced to him by a mutual friend who's in the NBA. And he said, he texted me and he said, hey, there's this guy that you really need to meet. I'm going to make it a text introduction. He needs to talk to you. Said, okay. And so they made the text introduction moments later. And then the guy asked when I was available to meet. And literally, this was on Monday. We met Tuesday night for dinner. He owns two restaurants in Orlando. One is in the top five best restaurant, nicest restaurants in Orlando. And then the second one was he just converted. He's owned it for 15 years, and he just converted it from an indoor golf place to a higher end thing. And he wanted me to try like every entree on the menu. And of course I eat like a bird, so I hardly eat anything. And they were throwing all this food and wanting me to just order half the menu. But we ended up talking about things and kind of getting to know one another. And, in fact, and that's called Tomko's Tavern. And if you're in Orlando, he owns Vines as well. But if you're in Orlando, I highly recommend that you hit Tomko's. It's Tomkos Tavern. Amazing place. Great, great, great food. Great atmosphere. You literally, he's got indoor golf simulators where you can swing as hard as you want, and you can play any course in the world. He also added like soccer balls, because we have Orlando City here. So he's got soccer balls and indoor soccer fields. And I mean, he's got a place for live music, and then he's got a private VIP area in the back that's just swanky. I mean, it's just a really fun, awesome, cool place. Anyway, we were visiting, and he was reading this book, and then he called me Wednesday morning. And he said, this was amazing. Can I give it to my son? I said, of course. He did that one and another one that I have, Born to be Rich, the very first one. And so I just go back and I see some of the influence that's still happening that never would have happened if it wasn't for the Senate race. And he told me, he said, I did a 90-day race. He said, it ended up being more like 6 months. But whenever I first started my career, this man is in the Poker Hall of Fame. He is the world champion poker player. He's in Vegas right now on the world championships. You'll see it on ESPN. This guy is trying to do right and trying to live for the Lord and trying to get there and just in his growth journey just really awesome in how he wants to use his talents and gifts for the Lord. But he realized that he did a 90-day race, didn't know what it was, didn't understand the principle, but that's exactly what he did. And so that's what we're trying to do, is just help people understand how to achieve massive results. And Samuel talks about that the men of Israel had a greater understanding of their times. I think if you are a kingdom entrepreneur, if you are a Christian business person, I think you're responsible more than all the other business people in your office. Like, you should be, have a greater understanding. You should be able to perceive things that others cannot. You should be able to discern things that others cannot, about the market, about the timing, about when you should do something, because you can seek the Lord, and they don't have that advantage. They can't go get on their knees and just say, Lord, what should I do on this situation? Is this the marketing piece we should send out? What verbiage should we use? They don't have that. You do. Every time you believe the promises of God, regardless of how stupid or impossible they may appear in your life or in your present circumstance, that's courageous. That's courage. And, you know, I read a quote this week. It was on Pinterest, and it said, the name of the book, we're interacting with some people online. The name of the book is The 90-Day Race. The issue is when things in your present circumstance appear impossible. And they were talking about how courageous it is to wake up and fight the same demons that left you so tired the day before. That's courageous, my dear, is what it said. And I remember thinking to myself, how moronic, come on, you know, that's not courage. I'm sorry, that may be how secular defines courage. That's not courageous at all. That is stupidity. Okay, waking up to fight the same demons that left you tired and depressed yesterday is not courageous. It's stupid. What I want to help you do is be bold. What I want you to help you to do is be courageous. Not because I want you to be courageous just for me. I want you to be courageous because you're commanded to be courageous. I want you to be courageous because we're told fear not and be strong and be courageous and to not consume ourselves with those kind of thoughts. And so it's not for me. It doesn't help me. But what it does do is help the kingdom. And that's what I want to, that's why I want you to get better. That's why I want you to heal. That's why I want your mind renewed, is so that you can impact the kingdom the way you're supposed to. So, you know, what I've learned is that the sea didn't stop Moses, couldn't stop Moses. The wall couldn't stop Joshua. Goliath couldn't stop David. Death couldn't stop Jesus. And nothing can stop what God has called you to do in business and in life. If you feel like there is something you're supposed to do, a place you're supposed to go, someone you're supposed to reach out to, I don't care how ludicrous, I don't care how random it may seem, the bottom line is it's about you being obedient. It's about you doing what you're supposed to do. You can't change anybody. Think about how hard it is to change yourself. You're definitely not going to change anybody else. And quite frankly, you can't even change yourself. The more you try to change yourself, it's just like fighting and grinding. You know, he can change. He's the only one that changes us, really, through and through. And so you have to understand that that there's going to be obstacles. There's going to be problems. You're going to, as an entrepreneur, man, you're going to have so many emotions. Your emotions are going to be all over the board. I mean, I remember being the CEO of the hoverboard company. And I've talked about it sometimes, but, you know, we had over 300 Chinese manufacturers knocking off our products. It's costing us so much revenue and sales, and, the culture did not see it as wrong. They just saw that that's just business. And so, you know, I'm trying to figure out how do you compete with that? Like, really, how do you compete? And so I was in the conference room, which, with the inventor. And he had a number of other inventions, and his wife and his daughter, and we literally locked ourselves in there for, it took 3 days. We didn't know how long it would take, but we said until there is agreement, we're not leaving this room. And literally food was brought in. There were no breaks. There, nothing else was important in all of life for 3 days. And I finally got some agreement to be able to implement a plan where we were able to get 19 of the manufacturers to come together, pay a one-time retribution payment, and then we would give them minimum standards so that they wouldn't catch fire and some other problems that they were having with the way they were manufacturing. And then we got a royalty off of all future sales, but we were basically approving them and authorizing them, put our blessing on it. So then I did that way. Now I'm not competing with the Chinese. It's not the Americans versus the Chinese. It was Chinese versus Chinese. And they're not going to screw each other because, you know, they live, they're neighbors. And so, that was one of the most effective strategies because it took it to 19, ones that we were actually working with the other 200, you know, and 81, really were, irrelevant and phased out. So, That was one of the things that we did. The second thing was I created a second brand. Okay, now this was what caused the problems. The brand of the hoverboard was very prestigious. It was high end. It was not your typical toy. even though it was the single hottest global consumer product of 2019, it was expensive. It was not, you know, your $20 Chia Pet. So what we had to do was recognize that this was being used as personal transportation on college campuses. It was being used as personal transportation for, you know, people who normally would walk to work at a retail or strip center. And I still will see somebody. I was in an office last week with a company that we recently acquired, and saw their sales manager was getting around on a hoverboard. And so, a lot of great memories still, and a lot of people use it. But what I wanted to do was create a knockoff brand. Okay, so I remember, you know, we had Brookstone, we had Neiman Marcus, we had all these high end customers, clients, obviously Toys R Us. That were buying the hoverboards, seven figure orders, you know, coming through. And if we messed this up, then it would totally backfire on the entire business model. So what we wanted to do was make it to where, we came out with we knocked off our own product. I wanted to knock off every single one of our products before we launched them. So the moment I launch and introduce a new product in the market, I also create my own knockoff. That's a fraction of the cost. It's not going to, the battery's not going to go as long. The thing may break in a month. This other one's going to last for years. But whatever it is, bottom line, we're knocking off our own product. So I created a brand specifically for that. The company still owned it. It's kind of like, you know, Taco Bell owning, Yum Brands owning KFC and Taco Bell. It'd be like if you own Subway and Hardee's and a McDonald's and you know, customer gets mad at you at McDonald's. They're like, I'm going to Hardee's or Burger King. Okay, great. See you across the street. I still get the money. You know, that was kind of the thinking was, I don't mind, because buyers are very different. Okay. So you've got the high end buyers. You've got buyers who always buy cheap. I would never be able to convince the person who buys knockoffs. I would never be able to sell them, no matter how much marketing I ever did or how brilliant or whatever else. I just would never be able to convince them why they should buy the higher ticket item. So, and conversely, the people who ultimately are consistently buying the high end item, they don't feel good about buying the knockoff either. They just don't like it. It's not who they are. They feel fake. They feel inauthentic. You know, they're not going to be carrying around a knockoff Louis Vuitton purse or, you know, something like that. They're buying the real deal because that's just kind of, how they view themselves and how they see themselves. So that was how we catered to this in the business landscape. But what I want to do, we've got a minute before a break, and then whenever I come back, I'm giving you 12 ways to know if the people in your life are being bold or stupid. And I'm telling you right now, and we're going to be closing with some haters. And I'm going to give you some specific things and biblical things on how to handle that. And I'm telling you, there's so much for us to dive into, that I want to make sure that you're ready to absorb. So go ahead and call us 407-682-9595 after we'll be coming back after a word from our incredible sponsors.
Some attribute the saying to the Greek philosopher Aristotle.
If you want to avoid criticism, all you have to do is say nothing. Do nothing. Be nothing.
On the other hand, if you design your life as purpose for something worthy,
and being a plate for those purposes, stand, there's a sure. Barking dogs, dynamic new dogs, dirty bark, guards, the illustrates the things concerned with the voices that fall. Don't think of it as possible. You are unable to see a future alive with opportunities waiting to be seized. Unfortunately, these barking dogs are often right in our own heads. Simply go to Amazon.com and type in dogs, don't bark, and park cars, and receive the wisdom gleaned from the author's own experience and hundreds of successful CEOs they interviewed over a decade, enabling you to bridge the chasm that is normally crossed only through trial and error. Get unstuck. Eliminate the frustration in building your business. The authors inspire and instruct those pursuing this journey with a central purpose to exalt freedom through ethical capitalism. Entrepreneurs, business people, and Christian leaders, mark your calendars now for the 3-day, 2-night, all-inclusive, faith-based Bahamas CEO cruise, departing West Palm Beach October 7th through the 9th.
for only $49 per person plus port taxes and fees. For $49, you can join former Hoverboard CEO and Kingdompreneur radio host Dr. Rollan Roberts on this incredible experience, providing access to world-renowned business titans. It's access, relationships, business, worship, and breakthroughs in your swimsuit. Reserve your cabin now at www.ceocruise.com. Kingdompreneur Radio is brought to you by Cardiff Lexington Corporation, a publicly traded company under symbol CDIX. If you're a business owner interested in selling to pull equity out of your business and would like to stay on board or are looking for growth capital, visit www.cardifflexington.com.
Welcome back to Kingdompreneur Radio. I'm your host, Dr. Rollan Roberts, and I'm talking about bold versus stupid today and how you can know the difference. I want you to be bold. I want you to be courageous. I don't want you to be stupid. All right, in life or business or relationships, and we've all been there. Oh, my goodness, have we been there. Time does not allow us to talk about how we've been there, but I certainly want to hear yours. Call in at 407-682-9595. No matter where you are in the world, we have thousands of people who watch from other places, and so we want to, obviously, you can participate as well. 407-682-9595. Give us your thoughts. I want to give you 12 ways to know if the people in your life, though, we've been talking so much about you. Are you making good decisions or bad decisions and bold and courageous or stupid? And I want to give you 12 ways to know if you, the people in your life are being bold or stupid. You know, it's one thing for you to vet yourself, and really it's a whole nother level of wisdom and discernment to be able to do that with other people in your life. All right. So I'm going to give you 12 of them. Number one. The difference between people is in who you pursue. It's in who you pursue. Who you pursue will reveal your character and your sense of purpose. It shows people where you are, like in your thinking. Do you pursue people who love God? I don't mean just go to church on Sundays. I don't mean just show up and kind of do the head nod and yeah. I mean the people who pursue Him. Do you pursue people? Are you even attracted to people that are like that? Who you pursue reveals your heart and where you are in your thinking. Number two, who you are and what you've chosen to magnify in your mind. You know, everyone is a collection of parts. Everyone, there's a lot of different pieces to every person. You will decide what you magnify in a person. You can magnify their problems. You might magnify their insecurities. You may magnify their strengths. You may magnify their looks. You can magnify a lot of different things. You choose what you magnify, but when I see people magnifying the wrong things in people, that is a red flag. And so much of the Proverbs tell us to stay away from the wrong kinds of people. Make no friends with an angry man. You know, have no association with people that are quick to temper and have a short fuse. You know, make no friends. Don't hang around them. Don't lend them money. There's a lot of principles about that. So if you want to know if the people in your life are being bold or stupid, number one, look at who they're pursuing. Number two, looking at what they've chosen to magnify in their mind. Number three, I want you to see what are you willing to ignore? What are you willing to ignore? Because you have to decide and you have to recognize that every battle does not have a reward. Every battle does not have a reward. This is a hard thing for people to learn in relationships. It's a hard thing to learn. It's easier in business for me. I don't know about you, but it's a lot easier because, I mean, you just get it. There's only so much time in the day. I don't have time to fight with you about every little thing. But in relationships, sometimes, we engage in dialogue and arguments for the sake of being right, as opposed to recognizing that there is no good outcome here. There's no reward. What would be a good outcome is for us to have healthy communication and respect and honor and amazing healthy dialogue. That's success. What's not success is ignoring the obvious. What's not is when someone has a temper and you ignore it. When someone doesn't lead you to the cross and you ignore it. When someone in business takes advantage of you and you ignore it, or they steal from you and you ignore it, or your partner has a drinking problem and you ignore it, or they have a mouth problem, a temper problem, they can't control their tongue, and they say, oh, I'm sorry, I can't help it. I'm sorry, you can help it, and you aren't helping it. That's the truth. And so stop giving yourself a cop-out. But you, this is what you are willing to tolerate. This is how you know if they're being bold or stupid. And when you hear people say things like that, I just can't help it. Oh, you can't control your own tongue? You know, I mean, you're not two. Yes, you absolutely can. You just aren't. And there's a lot of scripture that gives me 1,000 reasons why you're a dangerous person for me to be around, because you are a loose cannon. You can't control your mouth. You probably can't control some other things in your life if you can't control your tongue. You definitely can't control your thoughts. So what I want to make sure here is that you know the difference with the people that you are talking to. Number four, what are you willing to walk away from? Observe what they're willing to walk away from. Joseph was willing to walk away from Potiphar's wife. Samson wouldn't walk away from Delilah. What are you willing to walk away from? What are they willing to walk away from? Are they willing to walk away from the wrong friends? I mean, I would just stop right there. Are they willing to walk away from the wrong friends? Absalom, David's son, or Abnon, excuse me, another one of David's sons. Absalom killed himself. Abnon, or was hung, his long hair got caught in a tree, and he hung to death. Abnon, David's other son, had the hots for his half-sister Tamar, and he told a buddy of his about it, and he was like, man, I just don't know what to do. I mean, she's just so hot, and it's killing me, and all these things. And he goes, man, you're the king's son. Are you kidding me? David will give you anything you want. He said, so just pretend you're sick. He's going to come in and ask you, you know, what do you want? Tell him, you know, look, I just need Tamar to, like, make me some cookies and bring some milk and, you know, and I'll feel bad. I just need some rest and I'll feel better. And so literally what he ended up doing, that's what he did. He followed the advice of his friend. Bottom line, Tamar comes in and he rapes her. He took advantage of her right then. She was like, what are you doing? This is horrible for Israel, for David, for, you know, don't do this. And you know, what's interesting is after that, it said his hatred for her was greater than the love that he had had for her all those years. So, but my point is, Abnon did something he never would have done if it wasn't for the wrong influence in his life. Who are you listening to? Who are you listening to on social media? Who are you listening to on the radio? Who are you listening to in your life? Who do you text? Who do you talk to? Who do you call? Who do you believe? Because whoever you believe, whoever you trust, whoever you're listening to, that's the kind of thinking and decisions you're making in your life, and your business, and your bank account, and every aspect, your reputation, your health, every aspect of your life is affected based on who you're listening to. I love the verse where it says, but Amnon had a friend named Jonadab. And Jonadab was that friend. I want to know, who is your Jonadab? Who are you listening to that's absolutely destroying your life? You think you're being wise. You think you're being bold. You think you just really have life by the bootstraps and you're just going to make it happen. You and you alone. You and Jonadab. You're going to take the hill. You're going to build that business no matter what anybody says. You're going to date that person no matter what anybody says. You're going to do what you're going to do because that's your right to do it. Go for it. But Amnon had a friend. But he had a friend. But he had a friend. But he had a friend named Jonadab. Who's your Jonadab? Who's your Jonadab? I can tell you right now, the people in my life, I make sure to know who their Jonadabs are. I want to know who their Jonadabs are. I want to know the ones that they, when they're weak, they go listen to. They seek their counsel. That's what I want to know, because that information is how to keep you out of trouble. It's how to keep you safe, recognizing the difference. Oh, that's a big one. Number five, who you've chosen to believe. I posted on my Facebook this week, character, not truth, decides who you believe. Character, not truth, decides who you believe. You are where you are today because of who you've chosen to believe. And it could be the biggest lies of the enemy you've ever heard, and it doesn't matter. You believe it because you choose to believe that person over truth. It doesn't have to be true for you to believe it. You just believe it because it comes out of their mouth. How dumb, how stupid. And you've got to be able to walk away from anybody who has chosen to believe the wrong people. It will affect you. It will influence you. And you don't want to have anything to do with that because it's going to destroy and damage your life. Number six, the enemy that you're willing to confront or that they're willing to confront. See, here's the thing. There's a lot of times I'm not able to discern what I need to discern with people. Like I try, I want to, I ask God for wisdom on it, and I still can't discern. I mean, I still hire the person. I still date the person. I still do whatever. But what ended up happening is you have to see the enemy that they're willing to confront. Their reaction to adversity or an adversary, their reaction will tell you more than discernment ever will. So what you can't discern, you can always tell about a person from their reaction. Okay? Their reaction to problems, their reactions to adversity, their reactions to other people. You can always tell everything you need to know by their reactions. How they respond when they are confronted. This is the biggest thing for me. Okay, let's say somebody lies to me and I confront them with that. And I say, you know, you told me this, but this is what actually happened. If they get mad, which I could name a list of people that respond that way. If they get mad, that immediately lets me know that is a stupid person. That is a, they are being, or they, at least they are being stupid in this moment. That they are not being bold and they are not being courageous. They are being very stupid. They are not admitting and owning their mistakes or their past. And which means until that person's willing to be honest with themselves and me, we can have no relationship. Light and darkness have nothing in common. Do you understand that when you're doing right and somebody leaves you, you understand it's not you, right? Like, because the darkness in them is what is uncomfortable around your light. Light and darkness have nothing in common, right? So, the enemy that you're willing to confront, number six. Number seven is the weakness that they're willing to overcome. Do you grow your weakness or do you magnify it or do you confront to overcome it? If you have an alcohol problem, I would suggest you don't go witness at a bar. I would suggest that your friends, your real friends, not encourage you to drink. If you were on mental health, mental illness medication, the last thing you're supposed to do is have a drop of alcohol. I would suggest that the people who love you the most would help you abstain from alcohol because that is not how you get better. It's not how you heal. See, the weakness you're willing to overcome or not overcome will tell you if that person is bold and courageous or stupid. And the reason you need to know if they're bold or courageous or stupid is because that's going to rub off on you. You're going to either become more courageous or you're going to become more stupid, which in the whole point is how to know the difference because it's not always logical. All right. So the weakness you're willing to overcome, you have to create an environment too for that weakness to die. It has to die. And so if you can't put yourself in places where the temptation intentionally, where the temptation is going to be, you're going to be tempted. You're going to be in a place that you're confronted with whatever your struggle is. But I can tell you, you need to create an environment for weaknesses to die. You don't intentionally put yourself in those positions. Number eight, their reaction to greatness. Now I know I talked about to problems and adversity, but it also goes the other way to greatness. Are they intimidated or do they celebrate and respond to greatness? It will just tell you what impresses them. Who impresses them? You know, one of the fastest ways to learn about somebody is to ask and find out who are they impressed by? I mean, is it the country music star? Is it the singers? Is it the rock and the pop musicians? Is it the celebrities, the A-listers? Who impresses them? That'll tell you everything you need to know. It'll tell you how deep they go. It'll tell you how stable they are as a person. And don't you want stable people working for you? Don't you want to hire a stable person? Don't you want to be in a relationship with a stable person? Don't you want a stable husband or a stable wife or to date a stable man or woman? Don't you want stable kids? I'm telling you right now, understanding their reaction to greatness will help you identify if they are being very courageous or very stupid and if they are in the type of person that they are. Reactions reveal what discernment does not. Reactions reveal what discernment does not. You'll know people by their reactions. Number nine, who they've chosen to honor. Whose counsel do they follow? Whose counsel do they follow? Number 10, who you're willing to protect. David didn't protect Saul, and it embarrassed him. Whose reputation are you willing to protect? Whose reputation do you look out for? Whose future? Do they look out for your future? Do they protect you? Do they protect your reputation? If they don't, you need to know that is not very courageous. That's not very bold. You need to have a massive red flag on that person. You can't trust them. And here's the thing about trust. I posted this on Facebook as well. Everybody you trust is trusting somebody you won't or somebody that you wouldn't. Be careful who you trust. Be careful who you trust. Number 11, where you invest your time. Who do they invest their time with? Are they investing their time playing video games, going out to bars, going out to clubs, entertaining themselves, spending time all the day at Universal and Disney? And, you know, it shows their nature and their character if they are entertainment oriented entertaining themselves or even cocooning themselves, playing video games, watching movies, all of the binging, TV binging. Where do they invest their time? Do they recognize the value of time? That will tell you if they are a wise person or not. And number 12, whose instructions they obey. Who they choose to follow determines the future that they have. And if you're anywhere in their vicinity, you may end up making the same kind of decisions. And so that's going to be the difference in seasons for your life. We are out of time to talk about haters. We'll hopefully get to that again next week. But I want to share one thing to you, and that is that next Saturday we'll have Jeff Pearsall in here, the author of the Dogs Don't Bark, Parked Cars. I also will be keynoting the Women's Empowerment Conference in Orlando, Florida on Saturday, August 11th. Make sure you tune in on Facebook and on next week on our live stream, and we'll make sure that you get that information. 2 Timothy 2:4, Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world. Listen up, entrepreneurs. People are going to come in and out of your life because light and darkness have nothing in common. But God told us to not look back. You're not Lot's wife. Don't you dare look back and long for the good old days, or long for with the leeks and the garlics of Egypt, and long for the parties and long for the social life. Grow up, mature, man up, woman up. You be the man and woman that God's called you to be. And don't you dare glamorize an ugly past. You own it. Turn your mess into the message. And let God just really do a mighty work in your life and your business. Galatians 3:1, O foolish Galatians, who hath deceived you that you should not obey truth. Be careful who you trust. Be careful who you choose to believe, because it has serious consequences on every aspect of your life, including your health, your happiness, your peace, your prosperity, all of it. I do want you to join me on my next all-inclusive 3-day, 2-night faith-based CEO cruise. Had a great time at the Women in Ministry Tea and Brunch today with 400 women here in Orlando, Florida. Had a great time, and a lot of them were really excited about the 3-day, 2-night cruise. It's only $49 for our listeners using the discount code Kingdompreneur. We definitely want you to be on there. Stay tuned for Authentic Living with the Dynamic Powerhouse, Courtney Shaw. She'll be on next. She was there this morning. She's just a powerhouse for God. I'll be taking your business calls and addressing your struggles on Kingdompreneur Radio again next Saturday from 2 to 3 p.m. I'm Dr. Rollan Roberts, encouraging you to live your faith in business. Have a great week. All right, everybody. Man, that was a fun show. That was good. I did not get to the haters at all. Kind of bummed about it. But wasn't meant to be this week. So totally fine with that. Let me see if I can turn this down. It's playing the outro right now. So, for it's still being broadcast on the radio. But it's just for listeners. How to participate, how to reach me, how to get a hold of me. You obviously have already found me if you're live streaming and things. So I really want to thank you all for joining me today. And, we covered a lot of ground, a lot of topics. My heart is just that we help business people. I am so sick and tired of people losing. You do not have to lose the battle. You don't have to lose your family. You don't have to experience the pain and loss and suffering. You're going to experience it, but you don't have to experience it alone, and you don't have to feel lost in it. You can actually, as James says, have joy in your trials. Have joy. The problem is we're all going to have suffering. We're all going to have pain. The difference is very, 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 very few people actually are happy during them and have joy in their hearts, like legitimate joy. They're not having to manufacture it and fake it and create it. They have genuine joy. Very, very, very few people have that. But that's the difference. That's what I want for you.
So that's why, you know, and I want to share one thing that's kind of it's a prayer request. So if you're a prayer warrior, I need you on your knees, like, multiple times a day. And I promise you, you still won't be, I'll do how many times I am, because the spiritual warfare is great. When we are moving into a time where, you know, I'm meeting with different executives, and we're looking at different syndication options, and people are loving the concept of a call-in business radio program nationwide. And I want to make the right decisions, and I don't want it to be me. I don't want to be bold, I want to be bold and courageous and not stupid. So I have some meetings this coming week with the senior leadership of places, and so I want your help and prayer and on that front, and for wisdom, and you know, I was talking with one of the executives today, and he just said, you know, to my knowledge, he's been doing this 27 years with the company that owns nearly 3,100 Christian radio stations. And he said, you know, there's just nothing like this. And so it's so unique what we're trying to do. It's not surprising the warfare has been what it's been. It's been brutal. But I'm telling you, I have more joy than I've ever had. I'm healthier than I've ever been. And I know I'm just trusting the Lord with it. And we need your help. We need your financial help. You can go to CourageousExperience.com or VeryCourageous.com. We need your financial support. There's some equipment that we would love to have in the studio that would give you a better experience. But I really need your prayer support. I really just need people who are fighting in prayer. And there's a couple people I know who tuned in that messaged me this week that they were praying for me in that moment. And one of them, literally, it was a small but bold token of good from the Lord, literally at the time that he was praying for me. And I can't even tell you what that means to me, to know that people are praying fervently, not just casually, but like really all in for it. So I hope that you'll participate. Hope you'll be a part of it. If we are able to go into the syndication here over the next month or so, then, you know, we're looking at going from a listenership of 100,000 plus to, you know, nearly 10 million people. So the opportunity is huge, and we really just want to get this message out to more people. I think there's just not another place that if you're trying to start a business or grow a business or don't know how to handle an employee issue, or you're sinking and drowning and you just need a lifeline, and, you know, this is your lifeline, and this is the place to call on how to expand, how to grow, how to deal with taxes, how to get out of this mess or that mess. And so that's the kind of stuff that we're talking about. And I'm always going to be authentic with you and transparent. And I'm not perfect, and I've made every mistake in the book. My first marriage, are you kidding me? I screwed up all the time. I could just go on and on about, you know, the things that I've done to mess up. But I can tell you this. I really don't care about your past. What I care about is who you are today and where you're going. And somebody could lie to me. Somebody could still tell me that, you know, oh, that was in the past, and they're sitting there just absolutely gaslighting me to no end, you know. I mean, but I choose to still believe the good in people. I still believe, and the reason I do that is because I know what God can do. Like, I've seen enough amazing things. I've seen him do enough miracles. I mean, complete miracles. I've seen him move the mountains over and over and over again. Why would I not trust him? Even whenever I start to doubt, I'm telling you, the mountains have moved every time. He's always broken through. So doubting really doesn't do me any good other than cripples me in the moment. It cripples me from being creative. It cripples me from being innovative. It actually cripples me from having joy, which, think about it. If your joy has been taken away, then you know it's the enemy, because he came to steal, kill, and destroy, right? Those are the three weapons of the enemy. I'm going to steal, kill, and destroy. He steals marriages. He steals your joy. He steals your peace. He steals your happiness. He kills. He destroys lives. You think about all the alcoholics in the gutter. Think about what alcohol makes some people do. Think about the rage. Think about the families, broken homes because of things like that. Oh, man, let me tell you. He came to steal, kill, and destroy. And if he's got that power over your life right now, I'm telling you, there's hope. There is hope. But it's not easy. It's not easy. It's just like building a business. I mean, you can have the best idea in the world, but the execution of it, I'm telling you, is going to take longer. It's going to cost more. But it's totally worth it. My prayer for my online audience this week is that you will be very courageous. I loved that. Joshua 1:7. I mean, I've been talking to you guys, you know, for a year, literally. More than a year, because I started the Sunday Night Huddles over a year ago about being courageous. Joshua 1:9. Fear not. Be strong and of good courage. And then I just found, you know, or Saul, two verses before, and it said, be very courageous. And I'm like, oh my. I'm courageous, and I'm trying not to fear, but very courageous? Whew. That one was like, I don't know if I'm being very courageous. I know I'm being courageous. I'm being bold. I'm aggressive, but I'm not very courageous. And then that makes you scared a little bit. Like, what does very courageous look like? What does very courageous look like for you? It's a lot to think about. It's a lot to process. And I don't know what very courageous is going to look like for you. And I don't know what it's going to look like for me, but I know that it starts with the decision that I'm going to fear not, I'm going to be strong, and I'm going to be very, very courageous. So that's my prayer for you guys this week. Thank you for praying. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being a part of this journey. I love people that crave truth. I love people who crave wisdom, because Psalms 1:1 says, great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Or actually Psalm, and then Psalm 1:1, you know, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, or sitteth in the seat of the scornful, or standeth in the way of sinners, but delights in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. That's the kind of life, and that's the kind of business that I want. But you have to love the things of the Lord. You have to actually enjoy doing and obeying him. And I can tell you the things that break my heart the most today, the things that absolutely crush my spirit, is when people that you love have a disdain for his law. They have a disdain. They just have zero interest in his commandments. And the problem with that is it's the recipe for failure. It's the recipe for disaster. And it's the recipe for a very, very hard life. So this week, you be very courageous. And send your questions in. We'll be answering questions live next week. I actually forgot to answer one of the questions I had gotten via over email and Messenger and so forth this week. So we'll address those questions next week as well. Y'all have a great week. Love you.